Or plan B, take stuff down, put it in a truck, and down the road.
Jay, I got last two set cards. You want them towards the back?
Touring crews, roadies as they're called, have a legendary way of becoming very, very efficient. What looks to be an impossible task becomes sort of second nature.
On a normal gig, it's going to be about anywhere from 6 to probably 8 hours. This one here can probably take 12 to 14 to 16 hours today. It's a lot of stuff, but that's what we do.
There's something magic that happens in a large room that you can't recreate in a small setting. It's been great working in Elstree, but in the O2, we're anticipating another wow experience.
I wanted to take a couple of minutes to talk to you guys about something, and I guess it's something that you guys can't really sense being up here. Something clicked yesterday. There was an emotional thing that happened out there. We got to a point where it became absolutely seamless. The lighting, the sound, the video, and the performance made the sum greater than the parts. That's something that any director prays for in any kind of performance. No one thought that this was going to happen, and I'm like humbled by this, and I want to thank you from like way down deep.
Up until the very end, it just seemed like this is never going to happen, and then before I knew it, I was in London, bleary-eyed in the O2 to watch the first live rehearsal. That was kind of the moment where it got really real for me, because there it was in all its glory.
Everything is going as planned.
The other component here is this museum exhibit that we're going to take on the road, and we've got some amazing things.
We have Naboo, Coruscant, Tatooine, the Death Star. The Lucasfilm has every image from behind the scenes, from the sketches to the concept art. No one takes that much care with their property. Everything is documented and saved so they can reference it for shows like this. We all know Chewbacca. We had to have a specially built, really, really tall mannequin made. Jedi Master Yoda, even people that haven't seen the films know who Yoda is.
Someone says, here's a lightsaber. And you go, oh, great, big deal. They go, no, no, this is the one Luke actually used in the film. A lot of this is very fragile. We had to figure out how we could turn them on its side, how we could dress all the mannequins.
What's kind of funny is there were over 42 pieces of armor on this costume. It took us over an hour and a half to get him ready. And when you watch the film, he's only there for 4 seconds.
We almost feel like holy relics. If any of them got lost, stolen, or damaged, we'd all have our heads cut off by a lightsaber.
Jedi Master Plo Koon, he has never been on display before. On his faceplate, he's got this mask with tusks and little carvings. He was really hard to transport, so we've had to develop a lot of intricate devices that go in there to keep him stabilized so that we can put him on a truck and move him to the next arena every week. And this man here needs no introduction.
I do believe they think I am some sort of god.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Anthony Daniels.
The show needed a narrator. Anthony's been in all 6 Star Wars movies. He is C-3PO, and he's great on stage.
A pleasure to meet you.
You don't need to say Anthony Daniels.
I don't need to say Anthony Daniels.
He can just be there.
He can just be there.
He can go about his business.
He can go about his business.
Thank you. Move along.
Look at this. We really are on the Death Star.
In the O2, I stood there on stage by myself in the empty arena. I felt like a god. I felt like a Roman emperor. I felt like some terrible fascist dictator. It was a wonderful feeling. Please don't let me screw up the lines.
Anakin struggled deep within himself. But it was back here that he struggled. Sorry.
I can't believe I actually worked with C-3PO. I kept avoiding that fact.
You would have preferred it if I'd been in a gold suit.
Oh, that was right. My other note.
Yes, that is a flasher, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
So we're not doing that. Unless it's for a private performance, obviously.
We're going to open tomorrow on a huge stage. It's about 11 to 12,000. Normally, we would play this somewhere else before we bring it to such a large platform. It's terrifying, but you got to keep working toward that date when your audience shows up, because you've told them you're going to be there.
This is not brain surgery. This is just fun. So let's just everybody settle back and enjoy themselves.
Thank you. Well, it's 2:30 in the afternoon. We're doing our final dress rehearsal in, what, about a half hour, and I'm sitting out behind the O2. That means something's going right, or I'm just fiddling while Rome burns.
With movies, you have long shooting schedules, months and months in the editing room and in post-production, and it's all in the can and you know what the film is. But with live theater, you never know what's going to happen that night.
It is your destiny.
We're ready in about a half hour, and I want to kind of tell them that the emotionality of this piece is now directly related to how they perform.
Humility. For one time, listen to me. I've been listening to you for 1 week. Now listen to me.
I'll see how I feel.
You come up. Okay, deal.
All right.
See you on stage. As a conductor, I always keep 10%, 20% for the performance. So I never give everything away until the concert.
The big news was that we sent a tape from Elstree Studios to John Williams, and John Williams called me at dinner and absolutely raved, and it just lifted everybody's hearts. So we're off to a really good start, I think. I don't want to put any jinx on it. I just want to make sure everybody double checks and make sure that they're ready for the doors to open. And let's just not make any mistakes, except the really big ones like we always do. All right? Have a great show.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Please take your seats as the show will begin shortly.
This is larger than almost any touring contemporary music production out there. And so you're going to see Star Wars as no one's ever seen it before.
It celebrates this iconic music and these iconic images in such a big, spectacular way. It really is the most unique thing that we've ever done around the saga. One of the most emotional things about Star Wars is the music.
It takes you immediately, and you're out of this world. I mean, it's like you go into a dream, you go into the story, you go into Star Wars. It's like you become part of it.
This is where the fun begins.
We had the lasers, we had the music, we had the wonderful films, we had the lighting. And finally tonight, we got the real thing. We got this amazing audience.
That's fantastic!
I've become an overnight fan.
You watch the screen and you think it's what you're watching, but it's live. It's brilliant. It's fantastic, yeah, it's fantastic.
What I'm really hoping for is that it reinvigorates a desire for symphonic music. But I believe that there's a whole generation that never really understood how that stuff was written and was meant to be heard originally.
In the rock and roll format, you have visuals that relate to the music, but you're not concerned about being exactly on beat. Whereas here, every cut happens to the music. Everything you do happens to music.
In this presentation of Star Wars, we've taken the theme of the music and take and cut together all the images that fit with that theme. So you can really get a sense of how the music and the design of the music played into the images.
I guess we're all kind of enjoying our inner Star Wars geekdom, you know? This is like we're actually launching a piece of our own childhood memories.
It was really, really cool. Awesome!
What did you think? 10 out of 10?
Well, there you go. One generation to another.
The premiere turned out to have a lot of surprises connected with it.
Now all of a sudden it's this live show, they're going to take it on the road, it's going to play in arenas all around the world, and I think George suddenly went, maybe I should go see this.
There he was at our doorstep and was coming to see the show.
I sense much fear in you.
At one point, when we were showing a clip from episode one, George leaned over and said, you've got the old Yoda in there, what's he doing in there?
Apparently, Yoda was being completely recreated by ILM. This is something that no one's ever seen. I've not even seen it yet.
So the world premiere of the new Yoda will be when we tour the show in the United States.
You've taken your first step into a larger world.